Chairs, ladies and gentlemen. In my country, New Zealand, the indigenous people always greet everyone who is in the room, and I want to do that now. Ngā hoi whā, ngā iwi e tōne, tēnā koutou katoa. That means everyone here, those who live on this land, and everyone who comes from other parts, my greetings to all of you. It is an honour to be invited to speak at Paniastro University, and I thank both the university and the officials from the UNHCR for their invitation. I was asked to speak specifically about violence against women as a human rights issue, and also to describe some of my experiences as a lawyer and judge for more than 40 years, which is a period that began before most of you were born. Every woman in the audience tonight will at some stage in her life experience, witness, or be affected by violence or the threat of violence against her, or her friends, or against her family members, simply because they are women. International commentary suggests that violence is a factor throughout a woman's lifespan, starting in some countries from when she is conceived, at birth, and through her whole life until she is elderly, when in some nations she will be bullied, abused, or neglected. Acts of violence occur in every part of society, whether the woman or perpetrator is rich or poor, educated or not, and in every part of the world. It takes many different forms. In many societies, it is imposed because traditions require that women take an inferior place to men. It is used as a means to select the sex of a baby. In most countries, it is associated with sexual violence, assault, rape, or incest. It is used against a woman who is poorly educated or better educated than her husband. It is used when a woman does not wish to associate with a man who desires her or wishes to control her. It is used when a family believes a woman has shamed its members. It is used to frighten a woman into submission, to force her to give up her land, to terrify enemies by raping their women and children, as a form of mutilation to try to prevent a woman having sexual relations outside marriage, and as a prize for victory in battle. Well, my personal experiences of violence have not been very dramatic, but are typical for a woman of my age in my country, New Zealand. They include threats of sexual attack by an adult male when I was 7 years of age, and later when I was 18 years old. I recall every detail of every experience. Violence affects us all, directly or indirectly. And while I acknowledge immediately that the experiences reflected in the lives of some of the Cambodians here tonight will be much more horrifying than mine, violence has one universal impact. It sears the experience in the mind of the victim, and it changes the way a woman leads her life. For me, my personal, but more importantly, my professional experiences have led to a deep interest in the topic. And I will take you through just some of these. First, violence against women as a human rights issue. The simple personal examples I have just given you lead to two conclusions. Violence against women is a crime, and secondly, it is also a breach of their human rights as women. In the 20th century, the first flurry of human rights instruments, including the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, the International Covenant of Civil and Political Rights, and the International Covenant of Economic, Social, and Cultural Rights, did not single out women's human rights. Eventually, in 1979, after years of lobbying by women, the Convention on the Elimination of All Forms of Discrimination Against Women, known as CEDAW, was adopted, coming into force a few years later. It was ratified by the Royal Government of Cambodia in late 1992. The Convention is a comprehensive charter for women's human rights, and it's widely ratified. However, even with the full participation of women in its preparation, the topic of violence against women was not mentioned in its text. After considering the reports of states' parties to the Convention for more than 10 years, the Committee of CEDAW could see a clear pattern of violence affecting women's health, women's rights to life, to bodily integrity, to human dignity, to equality in the family, to health, and to protection at times of armed conflict. Finally, in 1992, General Recommendation 19 was issued, reminding states' parties that the definition of discrimination against women in Article 1 of the Convention includes gender-based violence, that is, violence that is directed against a woman because she is a woman, or that affects women disproportionately. It includes acts that inflict physical, mental, or sexual harm or suffering, threats of such acts, coercion, and other deprivations of liberty. Gender-based violence may breach specific provisions of the Convention, regardless of whether those provisions expressly mention violence. Now, that last sentence was written by the Committee of CEDAW, and this was a courageous legal interpretation of the Convention's fundamental norms. In order to ensure some active engagement in combating violence against women, however, the Committee then required states' parties to CEDAW to include in their reports reference to violence against women under specified articles in the Convention, such as Article 1, which the Committee interpreted to include the right to life under general international law and under human rights conventions. Articles 2 and 3, dealing with eliminating stereotyped roles for women. Article 6, directed at suppressing all forms of trafficking in women, particularly in countries that were experiencing or had experienced armed conflict. Sexual harassment in employment, equal access to healthcare, compulsory sterilization, and all forms of family-based violence against women were also to be discussed in states' parties' periodic reports. This was a very bold step by what was a weak committee, monitoring a convention that not many states' parties gave much thought to. At that stage, the convention had no enforcement mechanisms and was widely ratified because states felt they could gain international commendation for their attitudes to women without having to change their policies to any great extent. Notably, many reports that, as a member of the committee, I was to examine nearly a decade later, began with the refrain, "Women in our country enjoy full equality with men," often delivered by an all-male delegation. The simplest probing showed that this was far from the truth. Even in developed societies such as mine, for many years women's human rights were not distinguished from what promoted men's or the family's rights. When I first graduated from university, the whole issue of women's human rights and the discrimination against us both in the private and public spheres of our lives was never discussed. During my career, I have seen stunning changes in attitudes to women's human rights, both in my country and internationally. In the 1970s, the problems associated with violence in the family and the protection of children from violence, including sexual violence, rapidly grew to be a major issue. Family law and violence became closely intertwined. New strategies and measures were developed to deal with it and to protect women and children. All these changes were debated fiercely, but in New Zealand at least, our political leaders persevered, making sweeping changes to legislation, policy, and to support systems, and established a specialized family court. In the early 1980s, I became a judge of the family court, which in my system is by appointment after significant experience as a lawyer, and at a stage when you are considered to have the maturity to deal with the many conflicts that come before the courts. We had a huge caseload, largely because divorce had just been made easier and was now based on no-fault principles. Violence in the family was immediately an obvious part of many family disputes. We had a number of tools at our disposal: protection orders, community-based support for those who had to flee their homes, a payment from the government for women with young children who had encountered violence in the home and could not work to support themselves. After just 4 years on the bench, I was appointed by the government to chair an inquiry into medical research and treatment by one of our biggest and most influential women's hospitals. Although this inquiry did not involve the sorts of violence against women I had dealt with in the family court, it did uncover a widespread disdain, almost contempt, for women's human rights in the hospital concerned. Women were not told they had what everyone but the researchers considered to be a dangerous precancerous condition. They were not allowed access to their own medical information. They underwent intimate procedures under anesthesia without their knowledge or consent, so medical students could practice on them. But worst of all, they became very ill and some died as the result of a research program carried out over a 20-year period. This inquiry was to become influential in developing sensitivity for the human rights of women in my country. It has been analyzed, researched, debated in medical and ethical journals, and books have been written about it. It even had a documentary based on it. Attitudes to obtaining a woman's consent to medical procedures were, of course, applied also to men and, where appropriate, to children. Medical disciplinary procedures were tightened, as were teaching materials and attitudes to women and patients. It is known as the Cartwright Inquiry over my protests, and at the time I was mortified by the extensive public coverage and concerned by the inevitable backlash against me from the medical profession, all because I insisted that women had the right to information about their own treatment, to be involved in decisions about their care, and to be treated with respect and dignity. Shortly after, I was appointed as New Zealand's first female chief judge of the district courts, and then in 1993, the 100th anniversary of women gaining the vote in New Zealand, I was appointed the first woman judge of the High Court. The High Court's jurisdiction is supervisory. It hears appeals from the district courts, and also, at first instance, hears major commercial disputes and conducts criminal jury trials. Looking back on the many jury trials I conducted, most were associated with violence against women, both physical and sexual. I could take some small satisfaction from the fact that as just under 50% of the murders in my country were the result of family violence, the issue of violence against women had to be taken seriously. And this led to fundamental changes, particularly in police policy. Family violence had long been treated as a private affair, and the police were inclined to warn but not arrest the offender. A much more robust policy of arrest and trial was developed, and gradually the community became aware that violence, whether conducted behind closed doors or in public, would be treated by the authorities as criminal behavior. When I was elected to the Committee of CEDAW in the early 1990s, I became particularly interested in the manner in which states' parties developed and implemented their policies concerning women. Every state that had ratified CEDAW had appropriate legislation in place. But what was glaringly obvious was that, with a few exceptions, they thought that was enough and did very little to ensure that legislation and policy had a positive impact. So countries with a model policy for preventing violence against women saw no change in the statistical rates of violence, often because they had not ensured that violence against women was criminalized, that the police arrested for it, and that the courts treated it in the same way as violence between strangers. Far too often, the traditions around family life were not disturbed. If a man chose to beat his wife in the name of religion, or just as a plain exercise of his physical power, then the state did not intervene. Mentioning that there was a high incidence of sexual violence against the women and children of the family was taboo, and many conservative countries denied that they had any problem at all. The NGOs providing shadow reports for the committee would demonstrate just how deaf and blind a government could be. As the result of these experiences, I became intent on examining policies that had the intent or effect of discriminating against women, now known as direct or indirect discrimination. During that period, I was fortunate to be involved in the development of a complaints mechanism for women who considered that their states had breached their rights under the convention. Although I left the committee before it came into force, I'm aware that a number of the complaints and one inquiry conducted under the optional protocol are concerned with the state's lack of action or its reaction to violence against women. The optional protocol to CEDAW was ratified by Cambodia at the end of last year. By this time, the United Nations had become seriously concerned with the impact of human rights violations against women, vividly illustrated by violence against us. As a starting point, it issued a declaration against violence against women, expanding and further developing the work started by the Committee of CEDAW. The definition in that declaration stated that violence against women means any act of gender-based violence that results in or is likely to result in physical, sexual, or psychological harm or suffering to women, including threats of such acts, coercion, or arbitrary deprivation of liberty, whether occurring in public or in private life. There were a number of influential international human rights-based conferences that focused on the issue of violence against women, and the Rome Statute that established the International Criminal Court included in one of its articles that rape, sexual slavery, enforced prostitution, forced pregnancy, enforced sterilization, or any other form of sexual violation of comparable gravity comprised part of the court's jurisdiction over crimes against humanity. Extensive UN-based research has since been conducted, and states that have ratified the six major human rights instruments must now report on the incidence of violence against women in their countries and on the strategies that they have implemented to eliminate it. Structural changes have been made within the United Nations itself, and the focus of attention increasingly is on the impact that violations of women's human rights have on them personally, on their families and their communities, on the cost of healthcare and to the economy generally, and of the absence of women from the labor force because of inappropriate social conditioning or violence that prevents her from taking a full part in her society. Acknowledging that statements of principle are insufficient and that the indirect effects of states' policies and programs to combat violence against women needed to be improved, last year, in a major report of the Secretary General to the Member States of the United Nations titled Intensification of Efforts to Eliminate All Forms of Violence Against Women, the report reaffirmed the obligations of all states' parties to promote and protect all human rights and fundamental freedoms, and recognized that violence against women constitutes a major impediment to the ability of women to make use of their capabilities. States' parties have been asked to report on their follow-up activities to implement the General Assembly resolution support. support of the Secretary General's report. And in the report, the actions taken by 54 member states were summarised. As at a year ago, the Royal Government of Cambodia had not reported on its follow-up activities. So violence against women has become an important subject in international law. Over the years, these international developments led rapidly to a re-evaluation of jurisprudence around human rights in domestic jurisdictions. Excuse me one moment, I'm going to cough. Many countries began examining more closely whether they comply with their obligations under international law, assumed when they ratified one or more of the key UN human rights instruments. One of the most influential of these human rights treaties has been the Convention on the Rights of the Child. It is ratified by all but two of the United Nations member states, and given that no one anywhere in the world would have the courage to suggest that children do not need protection or would publicly refuse to protect and promote their interests, this convention has been well supported and has one of the best funded action programs of any of the human rights treaty bodies. This has had a real advantage for those who wish to ensure the same visibility for the rights and protection of human rights for women. Many of the violations of girl children's rights and integrity reflect precisely the violations against their adult sisters. Evidence of greater compliance with international human rights treaties became more common, and states were obliged to acknowledge that this manifestation of international law had an impact domestically. I can recall how astonished the New Zealand government was when in 1993, our Court of Appeal in an immigration case where a New Zealand-born child would either have to be removed to a Pacific state where conditions for children were generally inferior, or be separated from its father, who was to be deported, said that our international obligations undertaken when we ratified conventions must be adhered to. These principles rapidly gained traction, and so when I joined the High Court later that year, I was able in a handful of cases to apply international standards in the ordinary work of the court. Although cases are allocated randomly to judges, I was fortunate enough to have a number of major human rights-based cases assigned to me in the short time that I remained in the court. One gave me the opportunity to examine direct and indirect discrimination by examining the impact of an apparently fair and even-handed policy on its implementation, leading to a finding that the policy was discriminatory. Another illustrates how lawyers who have a good grounding in international law can influence the evolution of domestic law. In this case, a woman who had since left her husband sought financial compensation for the years of physical and sexual abuse endured by her. The facts were notable for a variety of reasons. She had adequate material to ask for a prosecution for rape, and I believe that she would have succeeded in gaining a conviction. She chose not to do this, as her husband was a newly qualified doctor, specializing tragically in obstetrics and gynecology, and she knew that a conviction for rape would end his career and result in a prison sentence of at least 8 years. She chose instead to take more private civil action for damages against him. In addition to the allegations of physical aggression, including threats, violence, and sexual assault, he treated her badly, constantly belittling her, threatening and frightening her with acts such as holding her over the railing of their second story apartment. Once, when his assault resulted in her cutting herself on a broken glass, he would not permit her to get medical attention and sutured the injury himself as he held her down. All this resulted in her developing a mental illness, and her professional career suffered. She earned far less than he did, and for a period had to be supported by her parents. After reviewing the domestic legislation and noting that it complied with New Zealand's international obligations under the International Covenant of Civil and Political Rights, CEDAW and others, I was delighted to be able to hold that the plaintiff's case falls squarely within the parameters of New Zealand's statute and international conventions directed towards preventing violence so that women can achieve their full potential in both public and private life. There is, of course, a great deal of international jurisprudence. In the late 20th century, for the first time in history, the public was made painfully aware that when a country suffered armed conflict, women as well as men suffered terribly, but that the women's experience was different from men's. There was widespread information circulating, confirming that huge numbers of women were sexually assaulted in the wars in Europe and Africa. They and their girl children became sexual slaves while their little brothers were pressed into military service. They were brutalized, killed, and starved in front of an increasingly horrified world. We all became aware that this was not a phenomenon based in a particular culture. It was part of a universal culture that undervalues women and treats them as easy targets for aggression. If nothing else drove that message home, it was seeing very similar acts perpetrated against African women of Rwanda and against the Western women of the Balkans. We could no longer say that these acts occurred only in cultures very different from our own. Those who work in the field of international criminal law are familiar with the judgments of the ICTY and the ICTR, which have found that sexual violence is a war crime. The judgments of these tribunals are notable for the fact that each has specific provision for the prosecution of rape as a crime against humanity, and case law has expanded the scope, finding that rape and other gender-based crimes are tactics of war that can amount to genocide and torture, and must therefore be regarded as significant violations of international criminal law. These judgments have had a signal impact on the development of the law. For the first time, such crimes have been singled out for particular attention, instead of being treated as one of the tragic but unimportant byproducts of armed conflict. Most women will look first to their own domestic systems for protection and support. And indeed, until they have exhausted their domestic remedies, they cannot normally seek redress from an international tribunal, whether the complaint be criminal or human rights treaty-based. For too long, violence perpetrated against us in the home has been treated as less significant than violence committed by a stranger. That is why rape by a man who jumps out from behind a bush is seen as much worse than the same act committed by a husband or father in the home. Fortunately, these attitudes are changing slowly. A murder attempt by a man which left his wife permanently disabled, brought before the Inter-American Court of Human Rights after years of inaction by the state authorities in a Latin American country, has resulted in changes of domestic legislation, mandating preventive measures, special courts to deal with domestic violence, and tougher sentences. There are numerous similar examples where states that have implemented changes in law and policy have ensured that their lawyers and judges understand the dynamic of family violence and are aware that it has a lasting impact not only on the members of the immediate family, but also on her community. The cost of healthcare and the inability to earn a wage are but two examples. As I said at the outset, these are not just crimes, they're violations of women's human rights and have an influence on the way she lives her life. Some of the measures that countries can take include improving old-fashioned attitudes to women, which tend to treat them as lesser beings than their husbands. Ensuring that education of our children teaches respect for women. Reviewing law to ensure that violence against us is treated as seriously as stranger violence. Educating our police, prosecutors, and judges about the seriousness of the problem. Arresting for violent acts, even where the woman is too frightened to give evidence. Improving the support available to women who have been assaulted, and generally treating violence against women as a serious public health and legal issue. I just want to summarize by looking at the responsibilities that those of us in this lecture room tonight might like to ponder. I believe that lawyers and judges have a special responsibility. First, it's necessary to become familiar with the law relating to violence against women in your community and to ensure that your clients receive the best possible legal advice and community support that can be achieved. There are a number of paths that those affected by violence against women can take. Criminal complaint of assault or threat of assault, a request for compensation as a victim of family violence. If it is state-perpetrated or condoned violence, and your country has not acted appropriately to protect and condemn the violence, then once your domestic remedies have been exhausted, there are international remedies, such as a complaint under the Optional Protocol to CEDAW or a criminal complaint to the International Criminal Court in more restricted circumstances. Less direct action can include becoming part of the preparation of a shadow report on violence against women when your country reports under any of the major human rights treaty instruments, particularly CEDAW. It is therefore important that lawyers become familiar with the vast array of jurisprudence at a domestic, regional, and international level. Referring to the international instruments which your country has ratified and making the point that the principles contained in them are part of the domestic jurisprudence can have a remarkable effect. First, it may draw a judge's attention to these conventions for the first time. And secondly, they articulate principles that emphasize and underpin all domestic law. These international instruments are, after all, an expression of the law recognized by all civilized nations. Without your submissions and your analysis of the law, the judges may have little to work with. Those of you who work in government or policy have a responsibility also to be familiar with the many international examples of policy development that has occurred around the world. Cambodia has a young population. It is axiomatic that this is both positive and negative. A disadvantage because much family violence occurs in the younger population cohorts, but an advantage because you are likely to be influential with your government and community leaders. There is strength in numbers. Judges have a responsibility to ensure that they treat violence against women with the same degree of concern as violence between strangers. We must also ensure that we understand the dynamics of family violence and do not fall into the trap of misunderstanding when a woman is reluctant to cooperate with a criminal prosecution. She may well be simply terrified or ashamed and should not be expected to behave in the same way as someone who does not know or is not dependent financially or emotionally on her assailant. In my long professional lifetime, I have seen the gradual fusing of private pain with community concern. Most nations now take the issue of violence against women seriously. Many are not very successful in their law and policy. But this too will change as we learn more from each other about successful and effective strategies, particularly those that are monitored and guided by our law, police, and courts. In the end, it is an expression of our fundamental concern for the human rights of our citizens that we all work together to combat the evil of violence against women in our communities. Kia ora tātou. Thank you very much.